Hello, and welcome to episode 8 of Fun with Robotics. About 2 weeks ago was the Star Wars celebration over in Orlando, Florida. And before heading over to the convention, my friend Bob Ross stopped by the house here, and he was showing me the progress he was making on the mechanical internal components of a BB-8 droid that he's working on. I videotaped our conversation and his demonstration, and I'm going to play that for you now. And then I'm going to follow it up with some video footage from inside the R2-D2 Builder's Room at the convention. So enjoy!
For now, but yeah, this is how this whole thing goes in.
So on the top here,
mm-hmm.
The dome is close to this.
Yeah, there's okay. A thing called the BMM. I'm just gonna give you a picture of it here. This is kind of like, didn't print out real well, but basically, and again, this thing is curved. I'm just
sure.
Take the time to do it. But these are the magnets, the coupling magnets up here.
Okay.
And the dome has something called the DMM.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the body magnet module.
Okay. Right, right, okay, right.
And the dome magnet module or something. But basically, this is the big one that couples the two together. And these are the ones that go around the perimeter that let it spin.
Gotcha.
Okay. You know, they kind of couple to the matching ones around right. There. So this motor is the one that would spin down.
So that there is this
that piece there.
Okay,
yeah.
So there's another piece that goes on top.
Yeah, there's
okay.
A platter and then a dome at
okay.
The BMM
okay.
Is up here.
And so, all right, so this, you've got to pivot that way,
mm-hmm.
And then is it there's
pivot
a pivot that
way.
Way.
Yeah, so you have full,
yeah.
Full. And I have about 30 degrees of tilt for the head.
Okay.
Figured that was enough,
mm-hmm.
This way and that way.
Sure.
Yeah, I figured 30 was plenty. And I have 20 degrees for the body.
So that's actually adding to the top.
Yeah, you could actually go 50.
50,
yeah,
right,
if
yeah.
You could, yeah. I mean, that's a right. Downward fall off or not. I'm not sure how strong the magnets are.
Right.
But,
And then, okay, so.
And then the motors.
You get the motor here that spins the top.
Right.
And then this spins.
Should have put the belts on first. Oops.
Now this mechanism looks like it's a little top heavy. These motors will hold that in place?
They should.
Yeah,
okay.
They're not stepper motors, are they?
No.
Okay.
No, they're regular gear motors. And they have the same torque as the motors other guys are are using to run their same gimbals.
Okay.
Which they're using servos.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided to try these things. Not sure. I hope this was a good decision. I'm not 100% sure if it was, but we'll find out.
Well, the servo's got all that gearing behind it.
Yeah, well, these do too.
Do they?
Yeah.
Okay, so they're gear motors. Okay.
They are gear motors, okay. Basically, yeah.
So that's the gear head there, I guess?
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Is it a planetary type thing? Or?
Yeah, because the shaft is coming out the same. Mm-hmm. tight tolerance there.
Yeah, very, very tight. Yeah.
Was in there.
Yeah, it was.
That's amazing. I've done that myself.
Try yourself, yeah. Simple minded. Let me turn it around.
Sure.
That's better. Feels better that way.
Likes that way.
Why, I don't know. Should be the same either direction, yeah, I think. But I wonder. So anyhow, like this motor goes in here.
Okay, I see where it mounts, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And is there two of them? Is there a match pair? Or is
yes.
It, okay, mm-hmm. All right, gotcha.
Position.
Oh, okay. Potentiometer.
Oops.
You want a screwdriver?
It's a small one in there. Here. Thank you. It does make it much easier. Everything's on bearings. So
sure, it's flopping all around.
Anything.
There's one right there. Thanks.
Yeah, I got these motors from Servo City.
So you get about the same torque out of those
as
a servo?
That's theoretically, that's okay. Going by the specs.
The gearing,
yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure. Now, that's a pretty big gear housing there. It's There's one over here.
Yeah, it's this one. Yeah. So that goes in there, so that kind of holds it going that direction.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So the one motor does the turning, and this is the one for the sensing?
That's the feedback.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this guy here, if I torque him up. That keeps that from flopping around.
Okay.
So it's kind of stable at that point.
But you have another one over here, so you're
there's another pot more over here.
Yeah, okay.
But
For the other
for
the other axis
position.
Of the gimbal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So now I'm just curious. Down here, you're saying that.
Yeah. What goes underneath here? Same flops all over. And the one thing I saw once I got this together is I got to make these tighter because
mm-hmm.
there's too much slop in it.
Yeah,
and, it's the belt can wiggle, so I got to tighten up on this somehow.
Maybe get like an idler gear. That
yeah, I think that might be the key.
That's kind of what I did with my R2 mm-hmm. for the center foot.
Okay.
You know,
yeah.
Two idlers.
Two
and
idlers.
Push it, and I can adjust them in
mm-hmm.
To put some more tension on that.
Yeah, So I'm not sure if moving this up, it will certainly make it tighter. Whether it'll make it tight enough, I'm not sure.
Yeah. That's always the problem with it. Is. You know, the timing belt.
So
getting it exactly to the right tension. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So then there's two motors. There's on the axle drive, which goes out this way, and I have a coupler that'll go in the middle. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if I have to couple these together or not. We'll see. But these two gears, timing belts, pulleys, will go on here like this.
Okay.
And one on each side. And of course, this axle goes all the way out to the, the wall itself.
Okay.
But these are on here, and then basically have these. I'm using the dome motors to power them.
Okay. Yeah. And, I've seen those before.
Yeah. Those will go up.
They fit in there.
Underneath here.
Yeah. That's nice.
So just enough room to.
So let me get this straight. This motor turns that timing gear.
Right.
And then so that's turning.
Right.
What actually contacts the inner wall of the...
This shaft will be much longer.
Okay.
Yeah. Like this will basically be on here. Like
okay.
So.
And the shaft will continue
shaft
out.
Shaft will continue out and couple into the interior frame of the ball.
Oh.
See, there's a
so
frame.
You're turning the actual ball itself.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's how all these axles
So it's got
works.
Like a,
it's
a hole.
The same way.
Okay, so there's a hole in there and it's fixed.
Yeah, there's like a hub. Okay. What they do, there's a hub.
Yep.
That
and then
attaches
the hub attaches
to the interior
wall.
Frame
yeah.
of the BBA.
Gotcha.
And then the axle attaches to that hub.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so your turning mechanism is through your tilt of the...
Yeah, the tilt.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Like
right.
this. Yeah.
Right.
This would give you...
Swinging the weight, so to speak.
Yeah, really. Okay. Yeah, the whole thing, you got to flip your head around because the body is what's tilting, really. This
so
is
as it's rolling forward, if the weight is to one side, it's going to actually roll to that side, I would think.
Right.
Yeah. The weight kind of like pulls it in that direction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah. And for a quick turn, that's when you... Twist
yeah,
the bottom.
Yes. Yeah,
theoretically.
Give it a quick,
quick
torque. Yep.
And because that inertia, that should stay still, but the body should actually pivot,
right.
which is
so,
what this is hooked to.
It'll maybe give a little twist to this, but the body itself, since it's light, will twist.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's all the theory.
Yeah, that's all theory, right?
Yeah.
Well, that sounds pretty
solid. That's pretty
solid.
Much what Ed's is,
solid theory.
Is doing.
Yeah.
The thing that
I can just picture it in my head how it works, you know?
Yeah. Oops. Yeah. It doesn't take much to get this thing off kilter here. I'm going to move it in a little bit.
Sure.
But,
you're on some.
A couple of screws.
Okay, should be good to go.
Yeah. So theoretically, again, that's what should be happening. Yeah.
Very nice.
Mm-hmm. And, this is like a slip coupling in here. Where the shaft of the motor actually just goes to this hub.
Mm-hmm.
And the top of this thing, there's the shaft within here. This piece here just keeps this thing from moving up or down.
Okay.
I mean, it's not going to go down because of
right,
the thrust.
Sure.
But you got a picture of the magnets trying to pull the thing out.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
So that this locks this thing. You know, there's like a bearing here and a
right.
bearing down there. So this thing prevents the shaft that this is hooked to from moving up or down.
Gotcha.
And it basically goes into this groove. Like this, the inside of the ID of this piece is a larger diameter than the shaft coming down. And there's just a screw going through it, through a large hole. So it's, there's not much slot, but it's.
Yeah.
I actually thought about making this thing a mouse hole. Like a mouse halter, so the screw should always be in there. Just push this shaft down and
lock
it in
there.
Right. But now the thing, I have to go back. When I was researching, I was all set to use Ed's drive until I saw that it didn't have an extra degree of freedom. And now I gotta rethink how this works. This has what I call, it's even more than that, 3 degrees of freedom.
Yeah.
Where,
one.
Yep. One, two, and three.
And four.
The basic ones. And then you really have four, and then you have a fifth one up here.
Right, okay.
Kind of discounting those. And a guy, Dapper, who's made up this incredible 3D printed one of these, he actually came up with this pivoting mechanism here.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's possible that, I swear Ed's, he doesn't have one of these degrees of freedom, of the three basic ones.
Okay.
And that's where I kind of like Dabber's, his design a little better. So it's kind of combining.
So this is based on, what's his name?
Dapper. That's why it's his screen name, D-A-V-E-R.
Okay.
And
is he an R2 builder or?
Yeah, I don't think so. I think he's just a BB-8. He's on a BB-8 bulletin board.
Gotcha.
But now, again, some of this stuff I copied from Monty. Like Monty had this battery box. He's going to be there. He's going to have his thing here.
So Monty is responsible for that hanging weight.
Yeah, now he did his with a gear drive. None of it is a direct copy. It's just like there's a bit of a concept. Like he's using a gear drive in here where I thought the belt might be sufficient. And Davers actually, these parts here move by motors fixed to the top of this frame, but are by bicycle-like sliding cables.
Okay.
And
interesting.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, yeah, and that's how the Disney BB-8 works. Like if you look at that, they use the same principle. It has two servo motors down there, and cables that come up that just twist it this way. This way. I got this thing locked. Right. It's actually easier than. Yeah, can do, like he has cables that can move this thing back and forth, and then the same way with this direction, doing this.
Okay, so that, the mechanics is very interesting. It's going to be a little bit of a challenge for the control of it.
Well, actually, it doesn't seem it really. Like, basically,
you want to lock that up?
Yeah, I might want to lock this up. Please don't stay apart.
Okay.
But your left joystick, at least that's how I'm going to do it. Mm-hmm. Left joystick will do these two motors.
Okay.
So you'll be able to go with the head, up and down, back and forth. Right. You can wiggle around, the head will wiggle all over the place. The right joystick is, that'll be for the motion. I put on left hand, and that's how all my droids go. Like pushing forward or backwards will make the ball go. You know, these two motors, which will be hooked together, one here and one here. There's two of them again for symmetry. But basically, they'll control the forward and backward direction of the droid. The right and left is going to do this pivot.
Right.
So if I want to go right or left, and I'll just pull it this way. A little bit, so the thing will push.
You could really
up
have,
or go this way.
You could have a single joystick with left and right doing that, and then up and back is the motion of the roll.
Yeah, so that's what I intend.
Angles, and then have another joystick to do the degrees of freedom.
Yeah, well, that's what I was just saying. Yeah, okay. Like on your normal DX6 or 5 or whatever, you have the left and right joystick, and you have the right joystick. So the right joystick is going to do exactly what you said. It's going to make these motors move it forward or backwards.
Right.
Doing this will make it go this way or that way.
Right, gotcha.
And then the joystick on the left is going to be for the head gimbal.
Right, okay.
Yeah. Yep. And then I have buttons on my Annex, the box that I have on my Annex, and that'll be for the turning the dome.
Gotcha.
One way or the other, just like I do with the R2.
Right.
Yeah.
Neat.
Yeah.
Well, that's fantastic.
And then I'll have another button to spin the base.
Yeah. And you have two buttons, just quick spin right, quick spin left, that kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Because all you need is a real quick acceleration and then done.
Yeah, it's not going to be going around constantly. It's just a couple of times. So that's as far as I was able to get for the convention.
Yeah, that's pretty far.
Yeah. Yeah, it was. I wasn't sure how far I would get, but normally I don't show things not painted. But,
I don't paint anything.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I don't know if I've told you the story, but I took one of my small robots to my wife's school one time. Uh-huh. And I thought, heck, if I could make this thing light because the parts are up in the head and everything. And I used a piece of aircraft birch plywood, made for model airplanes.
Right.
Some little third grader came over and took a look at it and said, oh, it's wood. And he walks away.
Yeah.
This thing had all kinds of like microprocessors and stuff.
Right. And just the fact that it had wood in
there. And a piece of wood in it for the base of the head. He was totally disgusted.
I mean, that's what I just said in my last video. I said, wood is a great material. I mean, it's light, it's strong,
absolutely.
It's easy to work with. Even the tools to work with wood are fairly inexpensive.
Yep.
So you can get 90% of the things that you really want to get done just with using, you know, good wood.
Good. Yeah, and this is all birch plywood,
you know,
and epoxy together, you know, and everything. So since it's, you know, staples are hot, plus it's not printed out of the PLA, which will dissolve in 5 or 6 years.
Don't get it in the rain.
Keep it out of the wet.
Right. It'll have mold growing on it.
Turn back into sugar.
Yeah.
So we'll see how this goes. I don't know. So like I said, it's more complicated than it could have been. Like if I just did this with a servo motor, I wouldn't need this. And, same way with the other one here. But I thought, let me give this a shot. The servos are sometimes noisy. And I thought, well, let me
That's
try
true.
These because but they're a little quieter.
It is inside the ball. I don't know how much.
It
may dampen a lot of. And of course, having the noise is kind of fun.
Yeah, it is really. Yeah.
R2 makes some noises when he spins his dome.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool.
I was a little disappointed with this. It wasn't until, I think, Friday, right? You know, a couple of days ago, I found out that this is going to be not good.
Honestly, I think that's probably tight enough, but, you know, over time, maybe the belt will stretch a little bit. You've got enough wrap around this.
There's plenty of wrap.
Yeah,
so I wasn't getting any warnings in my in the program that tells you what the belt is. So,
that was the problem that I had initially with my R2 center foot, is I didn't have enough wrap around the belt.
Mm-hmm.
So then I said, okay, I'll go around two idlers and then really wrap it around. Mm-hmm. So it goes almost like, you know, 7/8 of the way around the gear.
Yeah. Stock drive products is where I get a lot of this stuff from. Mm-hmm. These are from Servo City, but stock drive has a great center distance calculator.
Yeah, okay.
There's always a warning. Insufficient teeth engagement.
Yeah, right. I've seen that. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
You got to wrap it a little more.
Now, these belts, I discovered that these are metric belts.
Okay.
And these are, the ones for here are G2s, which have a little bit of a finer tooth to them. And these are G3s.
Good information.
These have a coarser tooth, the G3s.
Mm-hmm.
But what they are, when you read the specs on it, if you look at the side of them, they're much deeper than like an XL.
Okay.
If you know how an XL belt looks like, these are significantly deeper. And also, they're rounded.
Okay.
Yeah, they're rounded.
The XLs are a little bit squarish.
Mm-hmm. They are, and they're not nearly as deep.
Hmm.
So it seems like, if you go on the Stock Drives site, they tell you all kinds of great information about these belts. But I decided to use these things because I wanted better teeth engagement.
Mm-hmm.
And
it looks good.
Yeah. So again, for the feedback pot, you know, there's not a whole lot going on. We're just moving the pot back and forth. And but for the drive one, I wanted the bigger teeth. So we'll see how it goes. I still got to, put the set screw in this thing.
Yep.
The reason I don't have this one in here is because I had to offset, just the way the pod is and the length of the shaft and everything else, I had to offset the thing back midway on the this aluminum block here.
Uh-huh.
And this one, I got to offset it midway between here, so I got to come up with something something to allow me to.
Well, isn't it just a mirror of this? Oh no, you got the potentiometer.
The potentiometer goes on this side.
So you need one potentiometer for each degree.
You do.
Gotcha.
You can do it with an optical encoder, or you can actually do it just with positions.
Yeah.
But the thing has to know, every time it powers up, it has to know where it is.
Yeah, it's a start.
And that's
position.
The one thing that the pot gives you, so it doesn't have to go through some motion that, like, okay, I'm at the left position, I'm at the right position, now let me come back to the center.
To the center, right.
Yeah. I mean, it's not insurmountable, but I thought, well, they say we just want it simple, use a pot. Hmm. And so these are the plastic pots, which are good for hundreds of thousands of motions.
So, but this is the only actual motor, and then over here is just the potentiometer.
Right, it's just like a
one
duplicate
motor,
of this. Yeah, okay. One pot per, and that's how all the servos work. Every servo has a pot in it.
Right, sure.
Along with the motor.
Right. Yeah, so you just separate them.
Yeah, I just had to separate them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cool.
But, and now on this, then there'll be a motor, it's going to be besides the two motors out here, which you're using to drive the actual robot itself, besides these motors, and it's a double. You have the motor to spin the bottom weight.
And where is that motor mounted?
That'll go out here. Okay. That's going to stick out. Again, it's a right angle motor.
Okay.
It comes out about this far and goes down. I have to bring it. But anyhow, that comes out this way.
It engages directly in the teeth?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So
yeah,
it's I got
another belt just like this one, only much bigger.
Okay.
And that'll come out. And then there'll be another motor which will make this go up and down like so.
Okay.
Yeah.
You could almost do a linear actuator on that.
You could, yeah. Daver had used it like a gear rack. With just a gear that moved up and down. I haven't figured that part out yet.
Mm-hmm. They make some nice little
linears.
Linears.
That would probably
simple.
Work well, too.
Just make like some sort of bushing on here, and it just pushes up and down.
Yeah. Right.
And then little pivot point right here.
Mm-hmm.
That would work.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Very neat.
So, let's see how it flies.
Yeah. So you actually did order the ball?
Yeah, I did. This guy, Carrie Christie, who did this incredible job making the frame. Now, this isn't the skin, it's just the interior frame of this thing. But he'll have pieces at the convention, I'm sure.
Okay.
But they're just incredibly made. I mean, he had designed this apparently a while ago, from what I understand, but it was all 3D printed.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the strength issues and the degradation of the PLA, he decided to make it in injection molded, glass filled plastic.
Okay.
Which I'll tell you, you ought to see these parts. I left them home. I wasn't going to bring them down here, but they're beautiful, and they're all like really clever. He used pennies to lock them together.
Oh, nice. Yeah. All right. So biscuits or something.
Yeah, exactly. And then there's screws that attach everything together, for the strength and everything. But these pennies, you got to roll like 50 pennies. these pennies, basically keep the thing more or less where you want them before you put the screws through. Kind of clever. Yeah. And he suggests gluing them to get in there so they don't rattle.
Yeah.
There's a rattling droid that's going across the floor. So I'm kind of anxious to keep going with this thing. Like I was saying, I'm going to go back on working on the BB-9, but my guess is I'm going to probably be multitasking here.
Yeah, welcome to the club.
Yeah.
We got six different projects going.
Yeah. This thing always looks so screwy. This top, when you look at it, like if you look at it dead on like this, let me put it in your angle. Look at it dead on, it looks perfectly symmetrical.
Yeah.
Let me twist it a little bit.
You're right.
Player mind?
It's just like, it's like a Leaning Tower of Pisa.
That's a stupid thing. This isn't going to work. How is this?
But it looks like it's going.
Yeah.
It's like that picture where the steps are going both up and down at the same time.
Yeah. When I first put this thing together, I thought, the heck did I do? Yeah. This can't be right. I got to have something off. And then I put it in this orientation.
So there's three on each.
Yeah, there's three on each. And the reason I did that is I can take these three off and take this whole top assembly off.
I gotcha.
And then you just have the motor down there instead of trying to fish a long screw or something down there.
Right.
I said, all right, well, this will probably work.
Nice.
But it does sure look weird when you look at it from different
directions. No, sure, you're right.
Yeah, it's not. So anyhow, so I wanted to show it to you.
They were the ones.